Hello and welcome to the 4th Annual Speech Team Regional Performance.
Yeah, sure, you can. We are so happy that you guys are here. All the speeches and performances that you are going to see today will be performed at regionals this Saturday, which is huge. Good luck to everybody.
And we hope you enjoy.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
First, you will be seeing a DDA. And a DDA is when two actors perform a short dramatic scene from a play. They are allowed to use a chair and a table, but no other props are allowed.
A fun fact about our performers, Edgar likes to eat oranges with the peel still on, and Shanti has finally accepted this fact.
Now you will be seeing Dinner with Friends, performed by Shanti and Edgar.
Sarge,
quiet. Sergeant, damn it, be quiet. Tom, Jesus.
Sorry,
could
I didn't
you
mean
at least not?
I'm sorry.
You can't just come and go as you please anymore.
Shh.
It's not fair. If you're gonna go, go. Otherwise, I'm gonna have to change the locks.
Come on, you don't want to do that.
I am. That's what I'm gonna have to do.
Look, I didn't come here to fight, okay? I saw the light on and I wanted to say hi.
Hi. Why aren't you in D.C.?
My flight was canceled. They closed the airport.
Why didn't you call your friend, the stewardess?
Travel agent?
Whatever.
I did.
And couldn't she help you with all her many connections?
No, not really, no. I was 45 minutes from home. All I could think about was coming home. Don't worry, I'm sleeping in the den tonight.
You might want to grab an extra blanket while you're at it. Sounds like it might get pretty cold in there tonight.
Good idea. Thanks. When there is marriage without love,
there will be love without marriage. Relationships are hard, and if respect and support start to dwindle, no matter how much you love each other, the relationship will ultimately fail.
Tom and his wife Beth grapple with the idea that they are both to blame for their failing marriage in the scene from Dinner with Friends.
By Donald Margulis.
So, how was dinner?
Fabulous, you know, when it's dinner, they're not fabulous.
So, what was it this time?
Oh, you know, these incredible recipes they picked up in Italy. Pumpkin risotto, grilled lamb.
That does sound good. You didn't happen to bring any home by chance.
No, I did not.
Kids eat that too?
No, of course not. They never eat anything that good. Gabe made some macaroni and cheese for them from scratch that was almost as good as the risotto.
So how are they?
They're fine, you know, as always, they went on and on about Italy. Thank God their slides weren't back yet.
So, what did you tell them?
About what?
About my not being there.
I said you had to go to D.C.
And they accepted that?
Why shouldn't they accept that? You're always going somewhere.
Yeah, but they didn't suspect anything.
No.
Well, what did they say?
What do you mean, what did they say? What did they say about what?
About my not being there.
They said they were sorry.
Sorry about what?
About your not being there. Jesus, are you gonna cross-examine me now? Look, I'm tired. I'm going
to... You told them! I can tell by looking at you. I knew I shouldn't have trusted you. We were going to get a sitter and tell them together, face to face. Remember, that's all I asked for. Wait for me to come home and we'll tell them together.
If it was really so important to you, maybe you should have just come tonight instead of running off to be with your little girlfriend.
Where are the kids?
What?
Where were the kids when you told them?
I don't know.
You don't know? Were they sitting there?
No, they were upstairs watching a tape.
What were they watching?
What?
What tape were they watching?
I don't know.
You don't know what tape your own kids were watching?
I don't know. Some Disney thing. The Aristocats.
So, the kids are upstairs watching the Aristocats and you're where? The living room?
No. At the table.
Middle of dinner?
Right before dessert.
What was it?
What?
The dessert.
Some kind of lemon almond cake made with polenta.
Was it great?
Yeah.
So, you're sitting there.
This is ridiculous.
Tell me!
We were sitting there, and I lost it, okay? I just lost it.
You cried? You actually cried?
Yes, of course I cried. I'm only human. You try carrying that around with you. I mean, I'm sitting there with our closest friends, eating their food, drinking their wine.
I can't believe this.
Trying to believe that everything's just dandy, and I couldn't do it.
I can't believe you did this.
So what if they know? So they know. They were bound to find out.
That's not the point. You've got the advantage now.
I do not.
Of course you do. You got to them first. Of course they're going to side with you. It's only natural.
Look, this is pointless. I'm exhausted. Aren't you exhausted?
No, I want to know what was said. Do you mind? I'm entitled to know.
I told them what happened.
Everything?
Yes.
What did they say?
They were shocked. They were sad.
They were?
Yes, of course they were. They're our closest friends. Of course they were sad.
They were sad for you, though, right? Because I'm such a bastard.
No, they were sad for everyone. They were sad for the kids.
Did you tell them what you did to me? How you killed my self-confidence, did you? Did you tell them how you refused to hear me? How I tried for years to get you to listen, but you wouldn't? Did you tell them that?
Tomorrow, please.
I cried out for help so many times.
How did you cry out for help, Tom? By screwing stewardesses?
She's not a stewardess!
Were your cries detectable by human ears, or could only the dogs in the neighborhood hear them?
Oh, that's right. Go ahead, cut me down, castrate me all over again.
You know, I hear you say this stuff, Tommy. I can't believe it's somebody I could have been married to for 12 years. That I could have had children with, would be capable of spouting such banal bullshit.
Even now you're doing it. Even now you refuse to hear me.
Oh, I hear you, I hear you. Tell me your girlfriend feeds you this crap, Tommy, because I can't believe you came up with it on your own.
Oh, don't patronize me. I don't need Nancy to tell me
about
it.
Don't tell me about being patronized. You patronized me all along from the very beginning.
I patronized you?
Yes, admit it. You never took me seriously as an artist. Never.
Oh, for God's sake.
You didn't. You never really supported me.
I supported you. I supported you throughout our entire marriage. How can you say I didn't support you? You needed more time yourself, help with the kids. I got you a nanny. You needed your own space. I built you one over the garage. God only knows what the hell you do up there all day.
All I ever wanted from you is respect. You know that? For me, for my art.
Oh, your art.
Get out of here.
You held this marriage hostage to your goddamn art.
Get out.
Do you know what it's like having to support something you don't believe in, huh? Do you, Beth? It's exhausting.
I don't want to talk anymore.
The lying lied to you, lied
get
to myself.
Get out!
What was I supposed to say? That I thought your art sucked? That was just an excuse not to get a job like everyone else and actually do something with your life.
How dare you!
I couldn't do that, could I? Everything depended on perpetuating this myth of talent. Oh, you want to fight, huh? You want to hit me? Hit me!
Go
ahead, hit me! Look at what you've done to me!
Look at what you've done to me!
I could kill you right now. I could kill you!
Try it! I dare you!
Thank you, Shanti and Edgar. Next up, you will see a prose performance. Prose reading is a reading from prose, or a cutting from a larger work that often contains emotion, character development, and some dialogue.
This prose will be performed by Edgar, and Edgar has earned the nickname Eggnog this season.
So here's Edgar with Perfect Moments.
So the standard commitment to work at the humanitarian suicide hotline is 6 months. Most people work 6 months and then they leave quickly. I was a volunteer there for 4 years. It started when I was 22 years old, and I was young, and I believed in things. I thought, maybe I could help the world. I was that age. Thousands of people are saved each year by suicide hotlines. However, just one mistake can mean the difference between life and death. In Perfect Moments by Brian Finkelstein, for the narrator, the possibility of a different outcome torments him as the thought, what if, continually, seeps into his consciousness. So I show up one Saturday morning at 8 a.m., and I walk into this church on 72nd Street, and there's a bunch of people milling about. But I see this guy that's clearly in charge. He tells us his name is Glenn, and even though he's got this corporate, Jewish, metrosexual hippie thing going on, he's also got a little bit of a drill sergeant thing. At the start of class, he weeds people out. And one of the most important things Glenn weeded out was people who were there because they were either suicide survivors, meaning they'd lost somebody because of suicide, or because they themselves, the volunteer, had either contemplated or tried to commit suicide. At the end of 2 weeks of training, there were only 4 of us left because Glenn was really good. But I will tell you right now, I was better. Because what Glenn didn't know about me was that about 4 years before this, I lived in San Diego, California, and I was dating this girl, Tracy. And one day, Tracy slept with my best friend, and I'd had it. And I bet you Glenn didn't know that I drove up to my dad's house in Del Mar, California, and I went into his garage, and I took his gun. I grabbed a bottle of tequila, and I drove all the way up to Torrey Pines Beach, and I took the gun. And I stuck it in my mouth. And I bet you Glenn has no idea how good it feels to stick a loaded gun in your mouth. It feels incredibly good. Things weren't going good for me, and I'm just pointing it out, just saying it right now here in front of all of you. It felt good to have control. To say, I'm going to put a gun in my mouth, and I'm going to have some control over something. And I sat there, and I was trying to contemplate doing it, and then I threw up all over the gun. And there's nothing that snaps you out of a suicide impulse more than throwing up on a gun. Believe you me, it really clears your head. It snapped me out of the suicide, and I felt this moment of clarity. I wiped the throw up off me, and I went into the water. It was late at night, beautiful, full moon. And it was perfect. I had what for me was the perfect life moment. And I realized that's what life is. There are these moments of beauty like moons and oceans, and then there are these moments of horror. And then it's good again, and then it's horrible and kicks you in the face, but then for a moment it's good. And for me, that was enough. Now, the training basically says that what you do is you ask a series of 4 questions. Do you feel so bad that you think about suicide? Do you have a plan for how you would do it? Have you set a time for when you're going to do it? And have you taken any steps today to kill yourself? Now, in the 4 years I worked there, 99.9% of all responses were yes! No. 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 You see, a lot of people think about suicide, but most don't ever really go the next step. The closest thing to a warning sign that you can have for suicide is if somebody says something like, look, I don't want to die. I just want the pain to stop. And if you hear somebody say that they want the pain to stop, a bell should go off. That's a person who's on the edge. So 4 years later, me and Adam are working the overnight shift from 11 o'clock at night to 8 o'clock in the morning. And around 4, it was my turn to answer. The phone rings, and I pick it up, and this young, cute, but scared voice comes on the phone and says, hi, my name's Amy. I'd like to talk. And I say, what's up, Amy? What's going on? And she says, oh, nothing. I was just calling because I was feeling a little sad. And I was like, what are you sad about? And she said, everything. Nothing. I don't know. I just feel so stupid. And she started to sound uncomfortable, and then she said she felt dumb because of depression. And I noticed it was about time to wrap it up, but Amy started telling me this story about going to someplace with her family one day, and her father bought her ice cream, and that it was a great day. And I said, oh, that's great. And I looked at the clock. But then Amy started to slur her speech a little bit. I said, Amy, what's going on? Are you okay? I don't want to die. I just want the pain to stop. And I woke up. Amy what have you done? And she told me she took 20 high-strength painkillers, and I said, what kind of painkillers? Because that's what you're supposed to ask. And she told me, and I wrote it down, and I tried to keep Amy talking. And I was trying to ask her about other things, and she was again talking about that day her father bought her ice cream. And then Adam came back with a piece of paper. He called poison control, and I said, Amy, given the fact that you took 20 high-strength painkillers and that you drank and haven't thrown up, which I knew because she had told me, do you understand that you could die within an hour? And she started to cry, and I was like, Amy, look, do you want help? Do you want me to do something? I can do something, but I can only help you if you ask. And she goes, I do. I don't want this. And I said, great, what's your address? She gave me her address, I handed it to Adam, and he went to call 911, and I tried to keep Amy talking. But it was silent. And it was silent for 2 minutes. And it was silent for 5 minutes. And I'm supposed to hang up the phone, but who the hell could hang up the phone? So I waited. 13, 14 minutes. I heard noises at the door, and I heard the door crash open, and I heard footsteps, and I heard the phone being picked up, and a voice that said, it's okay. We've got her. I called Glenn and told him that I quit, that I wasn't coming back. And then I did all the things you're not supposed to do in that situation. I obsessed about it. I stayed up and I drank and I listened to the radio and looked through the papers, and finally, after 3 days, I found it. The Daily News, page 23, a small paragraph that said they had found the body of a 19-year-old NYU student named Amy Walters. And the thing of it is, I have had bigger personal tragedies over the years. I spoke to her for less than an hour, but I think about her every day because she's me in that car. If I had pulled the trigger, that would be me. And she never got to find out what I got to find out, which is, it's terrible sometimes. But then there are these perfect life moments, and that's enough.
Next, you will be hearing an impromptu event. This is an event in which a student is given a topic and they have exactly 2 minutes to prep a 6-minute speech.
Lily will be performing this, and Lily was fortunate enough to have her 18th birthday at a speech team tournament.
Lily, performing an impromptu event.
School, I was kind of a big deal. On the lacrosse field, that is. I was the best on my team. I had the most goals and stopped the most people on defense. So when it came time to try out for the national team, I didn't need to practice. I had it in the bag. But when I got there, I was shocked to find out that everyone there was also the best person on their lacrosse team. And they had been practicing for months. When I got there, I was ready to go, and all of a sudden, boom, fell flat on my face in front of everyone. I was devastated, and my lacrosse dreams quickly faded out of my hands because I had no preparation. I had never been challenged, and I was just a little too cocky. This relates to today's quote by Frederick Douglass. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. If we are never struck with adversity in our life, we can never achieve greatness. But it is possible to achieve greatness through 3 key things. We need to remember that it takes time, it takes action, and it takes perseverance. But first, greatness takes time. And a great example of this is in the Chicago Cubs. The Chicago Cubs know what it means to struggle, and they know what it means to struggle for 108 years. But they were also aware that greatness doesn't come right away. It takes time, and it takes reevaluating your strategy to achieve something that you never thought possible. The Cubs at first were a little conflicted with their struggle. They blamed it on other things, such as a goat, or some of their fans completely gave up on them. But they knew that with a little time and a little revamping of what they had always done, they could achieve something that no one expected. So a few years ago, they did something completely new. They changed their roster, they changed their management, and they changed their game plan. And this year, they achieved greatness in the best way possible, with the World Series trophy. Similarly, we need to know that while it takes time, it also takes action. This is a perfect example seen through the Women's Convention at Seneca Falls. At Seneca Falls, we see Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott, who met at the World Anti-Slavery Convention, where they were barred from speaking on the floor. There, they knew that they were put in a struggle, but instead of letting that get to them, they decided to take action and start the first women's rights movement in America. They thought that because this was something never done before, it might not be a success. They held it in a little chapel and hoped to see maybe 20, 30 people coming. But on the first day, when it was open to only women, 200 people showed up. And on the next day, when they opened up to men too, famous abolitionists such as Frederick Douglass came. They achieved greatness by seeing their struggle and taking action, because they knew that they could change the history of America. It just took one small step. Finally, we need to see that achieving greatness takes perseverance. A great example of this is in Bethany Hamilton, world-renowned surfer. As a child, Bethany knew that she was going to be an amazing surfer one day. She trained every day as hard as she could and soon rose in the ranks throughout the world, preparing to be number one. Until one day, when she was out on a fun surf with her friends, and a shark bit her arm clean off. She lost 60% of her blood, barely even surviving. In that moment, she could have stopped her surfing career, and that's what everyone expected her to do. But she reminded herself that her goal was greatness, so she persevered through that. She decided to train in a way that nobody had done before, with one arm. And though she never got to that number one in the world spot, she soon began winning competitions that no one expected someone with only one arm to win. She became an inspiration for the disabled world and became someone who truly achieved greatness, not only in her eyes, but in the eyes of everyone in the surfing world. Overall, we can see that greatness does not come easy. It takes time, it takes action, and it takes perseverance. This relates to today's quote, "If there is no struggle, there is no progress," by Frederick Douglass. In my case, I never really had a struggle. No one had given me any challenge on the lacrosse field, so I just assumed I was great. Obviously, I was wrong. What I learned in that moment was the only way you can truly do your best is to challenge yourself. I now know that before I go after something, I need to remember that it takes time in my preparation. It will take persevering through the tough things when I think it's just getting too hard. And it will take me taking action and not letting those other people who are more prepared than me scare me. Through this, I've learned that achieving greatness is truly possible. It just might take a little struggle first.
Next up, we will have Charlotte with DEC. In a DEC, the speaker finds a written speech, essay, or editorial and delivers it on his or her own.
Charlotte's hobbies include speech team and going to the gym. Her muscles are so big that they almost pop out of her suit.
Here's Charlotte with Why Good Leaders Make You Feel Safe.
We give medals to those who are willing to sacrifice themselves so that others may gain. But in business, we give bonuses to those who are willing to sacrifice others so that they may gain. We have it backwards. So I asked myself, in the military, where do people like that come from? And my initial conclusion is that they're just better people. That's why they're in the military. They're attracted to that concept of service. But that's completely wrong. What I learned was that it's the environment. And if you get the environment right, every single one of us has the capacity to do remarkable things. But more importantly, others have that capacity too. I've had the great honor in getting to meet some of these who we would call heroes, who have put themselves and put their lives at risk to save others. So I asked them, why would you do it? Why did you do it? And they all say the same thing, because they would have done it for me. It's this deep sense of trust and cooperation. So the concepts of trust and cooperation are really important here. But the only problems with the concepts of trust and cooperation is that they're feelings. They're not instructions. More than 70 years ago, my own grandpa was a general during World War II. He led troops into battle, told them how to fight, but more importantly, made sure that they could trust him. Hearing his stories passed down through my family, I see his actions directly reflected in Simon Sinek's TED Talk, where he suggests leadership as creating trust for your followers and inspiring change and cooperation through relationships. Why Good Leaders Make You Feel Safe, by Simon Sinek. So, where does this feeling come from? Well, if we go back 50,000 years to the Paleolithic era, to the early days of the Homo sapiens, what we learn is that the world was a very dangerous place. All of these forces working very, very hard to kill us. Nothing personal. Whether it was the weather, lack of resources, even a saber-toothed tiger. All of these things working to frustrate our lives. So we evolved into social animals working together in what I call a circle of safety. Inside the tribe where we feel like we belong. And when we feel safest amongst our own, the natural reaction is trust and cooperation. There are inherent benefits to this. It means I can fall asleep at night and trust that someone from within my tribe will stay up and watch for danger. The modern day is exactly the same thing. The world is filled with danger trying to frustrate our lives, reduce our success, reduce our opportunity for success. Or it could be your competition trying to kill you, trying to take away your business, or very minimally, trying to frustrate your growth. All of these forces are constant. We can't change them, and they are not going away. The only variables are the conditions inside the organization, where leadership matters most, because it's the leader that sets the tone. When the leader makes the choice to put the safety of the lives of the people inside the organization first, remarkable things happen. The best analogy I can give for what being a great leader is like being a great parent. What do you think of when you hear great parents? Well, we want to give our child education, opportunities, discipline them when necessary, all so that they could achieve more than we ever could. Great leaders want exactly the same thing. Charlie Kim, who's the CEO of a company called NextJump, makes the point, if you ever had hard times in your family, would you ever consider laying off one of your children? Absolutely not. So why do we even consider laying people off from inside our organizations? Charlie implemented a policy of lifetime employment. If you get a job at NextJump, you cannot get fired for performance issues. In fact, if you have issues, they will coach you and support you, just like we would with one of our children. You see, when people feel safe inside the organizations, the natural reaction is to gain strength and seize those opportunities. Now, would anyone have a problem if we gave a $150 million bonus to Gandhi? How about $250 million to Mother Teresa? Does anyone have a problem with that? Absolutely not. You see, great leaders would never sacrifice the numbers to save the people. In fact, they would rather sacrifice the numbers to save the people. See, this is the reason so many of us have such a visceral hatred and anger for some of these banking CEOs, with their disproportionate salaries and banking structures. But it's not the numbers. It's that they have violated the very definition of leadership. They have violated this deep-seated social contract because we know they allowed their own people to be sacrificed so they could protect their own interests. Bob Chapman, who runs a large manufacturing company in the Midwest, was hit very hard by the recession in 2008. He lost 30% of his orders overnight and needed to save $10 million. So the board got together and discussed layoffs. Bob refused. So they came up with a furlough program. Every employee, from secretary to CEO, was required to take 4 weeks of unpaid vacation. They could take it any time they wanted, and it did not have to be consecutively. But it was how Bob announced the program that mattered so much. He said, "It's more important for all of us to suffer just a little bit than some of us have to suffer a lot." And morale went up. They saved $20 million, and as would be expected, when people can trust the leadership inside the organization, the natural reaction is to trust each other and to cooperate. Leadership is a choice. It is not a rank. I know many people who are at the absolute bottom who have no authority, but they are absolute leaders because they have chosen to look after the person to the left of them, and they have chosen to look after the person to the right of them. That is what a leader is. I heard a story of a group of Marines who were out, and as is Marine custom, the officer ate last, and he let his men eat first. But when they were done, there was no food left for him. But when they went out to the field, his men brought him some of their food, so that he may eat. Because that's what happens. We call them leaders because they choose to sacrifice so that their people may be safe and be protected and so that their people may gain. And when they do, the natural response is for our people to do the same for them. Our people will give their blood and sweat and tears to see their leader's vision come to life. So when we ask them, "Why would you do it? Why would you give your blood and sweat and tears for that person?" they all say the same thing. Because they would have done it for me.
Next up, you will be hearing a dramatic interpretation. This is when a student performs a dramatic scene from a play, memorizes it, and then develops an interpretation of the main character.
At tournaments, you will most likely see our performer Tim checking his hair out in his phone in his lucky navy suit.
Tim performing The Velvet Rut.
I don't know. Maybe you remind me of someone. Not really a remind. I mean, you don't look like him. Anything like him. You're just young. It's crazy, just the expression sometimes. Or the way the light hits your face in here or something. I don't know. Today we turn on the news and hear about acts of violence more often than not. Unfortunately, the occurrence of one specific type of these events has exponentially skyrocketed over the past decade.
school shootings. On the one-year anniversary of one of the most horrifically scarring events one can experience, high school English teacher Mr. Smith reflects on the recurring nightmare he lived through exactly 1 year ago. As he grieves, it is made clear that no amount of guilt can change the past. Guilt only gets ourselves stuck in an uncompromisable rut. The Velvet Rut by James Dill. I took a deep breath, and the next time I exhaled, it was 25 years later. I started out as a substitute teacher and lived to tell all about it. I eventually got a great job in a great school, lived in a prefab apartment with my very own tiny balcony where I smoked pot on the weekends. I worked the Dukakis campaign, quit the Dukakis campaign, met my wife, fell in love, quit smoking, worked both Clinton campaigns, started smoking again, then quit smoking, but started drinking a lot more red wine so I wouldn't miss smoking so much. And suddenly, and I mean suddenly, it was 25 years later. Without any warning, I was suddenly in middle age and uncomfortably comfortable. And somewhere along the lines, I became this real good teacher. I mean, I never won Teacher of the Year award or anything like that, but I finally made peace with the fact that teaching is just another type of faith. I never hated my students, even when I wished they were more passionate about poetry and literature. And like, I never like succeeded eliminating the word like from the vocabulary. The secret was that I had figured out how to love it, but not let my kids take advantage of my love for it. You often hear teachers call their students my kids, like they're blood related, as if they're our own children. So, in that way, on that bright sunny day last spring, I lost 12 of my own kids in about 4.5 minutes. It took him all of about 270 seconds, and you know, nothing I had taught them could have helped them save their lives. Not the Iliad, not the Wasteland, not even Uncle Walt's Seeds of Brass. Forget Faulkner and Steinbeck. I spent all those years teaching all the wrong things. And my kids didn't need to know poetry or literature. That doesn't save your life in America. My kids need to know self-defense. The last kid, the last one of my kids that he killed, was a 14-year-old girl. A 14-year-old girl that he killed at the last minute instead of me, and she was sweet. Just sweet. And when he points his gun at me and asks me if I believe in God, I don't answer. But that sweet little girl huddled behind me, she speaks right up. She says, "I do. Yes, I do. I believe in God." And why couldn't she have just said no? If she had said no, would you have let her live? Would you have killed us both? Would you have made her choose? What kind of God requires something like that? And where was God in that moment? Where was God? No. Who was God in that moment? Who was God? You know? It wasn't me. It was him. You know, I think that that boy with the gun felt more like God than God did in that moment. That's what I think. And in that moment, This one single moment, this moment of meeting my student's eyes and of staring down a gun, I don't want him to call me Mr. Smith. I don't want that to be the last thing that I hear. I want him to call me by my first name, but he just keeps staring at me from behind this gun. But he knows very well that I know his first name. So I say, Matthew. And for whatever reason, when it comes out like a question, like, Matthew? And it comes out loud, Matthew? It's like I was trying to wake him up from a nightmare or something. But Matthew's eyes are open. And he has blue eyes. Green eyes. Blue-green. The way the Earth looks in those pictures from outer space. Matthew's lips are puffy and red as you've been biting them. His breath smells like spearmint. And in that moment, everything just flashed in front of my eyes. But in a moment like that, you would think that time would stop, right? But time, it isn't just one thing. It isn't stretched so tight. It's stacked. It's layered. It's impossible to trick. It always has you by the balls because it knows you can never get enough. You'll always want more. It's harrowing for the soul. The enemy and the angel. It laughs behind your back and it kicks you in the ass. Unless you walk backwards. And then it wipes away your tears. You can bargain, and you can beg, and you can even convince yourself that you've outrun it. But eventually, time wins. Because time doesn't run. It just runs out.
Next up, you will hear an extemp speech. An extemp speech is when a student is given 45 minutes to prepare an original answer to an assigned current events question.
Miles won the holiday PJ party by wearing only a white t-shirt.
Yeah, so here's Miles with his extemp.
Over the summer, my friend got a job at a restaurant. So obviously, being a teenager, I tried getting as much free food out of her as possible. I would either get a cup of soda or a bag of chips, whatever I could get. And it worked out for a while, until her boss caught her and she was reprimanded. See, my friend had a big trouble separating between work obligations and personal obligations. But it's obvious that she's not the only one with this problem. We can see that Donald Trump is dealing with the same issue. Except Donald Trump is the leader of the free world, and my friend was making minimum wage. So, when answering today's question, will Donald Trump successfully be able to separate his business interests from his responsibilities as president of the United States? We can see the answer is a resounding no, for three key reasons. First, we'll take a look at how Donald Trump has outright refused to establish a truly blind trust, and his business interests are being run by his children. Second, we'll see how a lot of his trade policies regarding China seem to be more self-serving than beneficial for the American people. And finally, we'll see how Donald Trump's policies regarding the Muslim ban have already shown this huge conflict of interest. But first, we need to talk about the fact that he's outright refused to establish a blind trust. A blind trust that, according to the Christian Science Monitor on January 2nd, every other president in United States history has established. Donald Trump is exempt from this. He has refused to establish a truly blind trust, and when asked the question, he said that he has. But a blind trust is run by people that you do not have any personal connection with. It's actually run by his children. His children are running his companies while he's president of the United States. And if the family connection wasn't enough, and that wasn't enough of a conflict of interest, the fact of the matter is that, according to CNN on January 2nd, Ivanka Trump's husband, David Kushner, was appointed senior advisor to the White House. A senior advisor to the White House has a marital connection with a CEO of a company. This is a direct line of communication between the White House and Trump's business assets, which just proved that Donald Trump's conflicts of interest are going to impact his policy in a big way. And they've already done this in a major way regarding trade. On Donald Trump's campaign trail, according to the New York Times on January 2nd, he continuously talked about how he wanted a better, profitable trade deal with China. He said that he wanted more jobs to come to America, but it's been proven and lamented the fact that this trade deal that he was trying to oppose would not give any more jobs to the United States. People still believed him, though. They looked at this America First policy and trusted him, and they pushed past any of the evidence that showed that this would do no work. So, when he did work out these trade deals, and when they did pass, many people were now excited and ecstatic about the fact that more jobs had come to America. But it didn't take a lot of discovery and research to realize that this was much more self-serving than beneficial to the United States of America. According to NPR on January 3rd, Donald Trump's business interests are reached all the way to China, because there's one branch of the Chinese National Bank, and it's in Trump Towers in New York City. Donald Trump, by weakening this connection between China and the United States, cemented his connection with China as in increasing his own business interests. Because when you're the only connection to an entire country, all trade and all money and all assets go through you. This is a huge amount of control that Donald Trump wanted to have. And so while this trade agreement was sold as beneficial for the United States, it was much more beneficial for Trump. But it's not just economic policies. It's also the fact that non-economic policies are already being influenced by this conflict of interest. In a recent Muslim ban, according to NPR on January 24th, all Muslims from a bunch of different countries in the Middle East were banned from coming to the United States on a travel visa. The countries that were exempted from this were the countries that had committed terrorism against the United States. So, this Muslim ban would not have prevented San Bernardino, would not have prevented the Orlando nightclub shooting, and would not have prevented 9/11. It did no beneficial to the United States of America, and the fact of the matter is it was completely unnecessary until some more people did some digging into why Trump wanted this Muslim ban so bad. It was a cornerstone campaign promise, and more people were looking at the countries that were exempted from this ban. According to the Christian Science Monitor on January 25th, the countries that were directly exempted from this Muslim travel ban were the same countries where Donald Trump had hotels, business agreements, and business partnerships in. These countries were exempted for the obvious reason that Donald Trump didn't want to disrupt his business relations with the Middle East, but he wanted to make sure that he looked like he was still fulfilling his campaign promises. His conflict of interest was spreading all the way to non-economic policies. And the fact of the matter is that as more and more of these policies enter Donald Trump's seat, you can see that his conflicts of interest are going to expand and reach out to these policies much, much more. So, when answering today's question, will President Trump be able to separate his business interests from his obligations as President of the United States? We can see the answer is a resounding no for three key reasons. First, we saw how he outright refused to establish a blind trust, and this is causing a lot of concern about whether he's actually going to be exempt from his conflicts of interest. And it's clear that with these trade agreements that are beneficial for Trump and not for America, that is already influencing it. And it extends far past economy, with the fact that the Muslim ban is also very prevalent and has a huge amount of evidence for these conflicts of interest. So, while my friend might have struggled separating between personal obligations and work obligations, we need to make sure that we make it clear that she was making minimum wage. Donald Trump is the leader of the free world, after all, not the CEO.
Next, you will be seeing an OC. The intention of an OC is to entertain. The content, style, and ideas are up to the speaker, but as a comedy implies, it must be funny.
Pilar is known to rock a blue suit and looks as cute as Parks and Rec's Leslie Knope while wearing it.
Pilar performing, running fully opposed.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, birds and bees. Just kidding. That's a topic for health class. Anyways, I'm glad you're all here with us tonight at this wonderful student council meeting. Tonight, all your candidates running for an officer position for next year will be speaking. First, we have Jackie Sanders running for the position of student council president.
Thank you, Mr. Gordman, and thank you all for being here tonight. As many of you know, next year will be my final year in student council, and as such, I will be running for the position of student council president. I'd like to wish the best of luck to my opponent, whomever that may be. May God bless all of you, and God bless the United States of America. And God bless boys with cute butts.
Great speech, Jackie. Well, student council members, you can all say hello to your next student council president, because Jackie, you're running unopposed.
Unopposed? As in, I didn't even win? I just got the presidency handed to me?
Well, if you want to look at it that way, sure. Well, there's no glory in that. No one great has ever won unopposed.
Name one person who's ever won unopposed.
Well, actually, George Washington ran unopposed.
Yeah, and look where that got him. He's dead.
Well, seeing as he was president over 200 years ago, Courtney.
284, actually.
284 years ago. That makes sense. Anyways, Jackie, look on the bright side of things. You will now be our next student council president.
I mean, I knew I was going to win. Anyways, no one has the brains to beat me or is more popular than me. No one is good enough to beat me. I mean, except me, of course. I could beat me, but that's insane.
Insane in the campaign.
But is it really that insane? No. I don't think so, right? I mean, every good leader has gone where no one has gone before. Like Lance Armstrong when he went to the moon.
Oh, it is pretty insane, Jackie. Most people just take their position when they run unopposed.
Well, I am not most people. I would now like to officially announce that I am running against myself for the position of student council president.
Are you sure you want to do this, Jackie?
I have never been more sure.
Well, seeing as that violates none of the student council election handbook's rules, I would now like to wish the best of luck to both of our opponents. May the best Jackie win.
Best Jackie? I don't understand what he means by best Jackie. Are you still thinking about that? He said that like yesterday. Usually when people say things to me, it goes in one ear and out the other. It might be because I got my ears pierced when I was 10 and I still have a hole, but the doctors are checking it out. Anyways, Jackie, I know you're like really smart and you take a bunch of AP classes. Do you mean AP? Yeah, that's what I mean. But it's not like you're running for president of student council because you actually care. You're cool, Jackie. Thanks, Courtney. That means a lot. I've got to go to class now. Bye. See you later, crocodile. Alligator. Oh my god, where? Were you just talking to Courtney? Yeah, we're friends. Why? Oh, no reason. I'm just worried you might lose brain cells talking to her. That's all. Anyways, how's the campaign going? Oh, pretty good. Courtney made a good point that I've got enough popularity to win by a landslide. Well, first of all, landslides are very catastrophic natural disasters, and if there were to be one, we would all be dead and we wouldn't need you as president, so I really don't appreciate you making jokes about them. And second of all, Jackie, don't listen to Courtney. For you, this election is way more than just a popularity contest. You actually care about student council and want to see this school succeed. You're smart, Jackie. That's it! Cool Jackie versus smart Jackie! No, that's not what I meant. But it's exactly what I need. Two different platforms for the two separate versions of myself. Well, just because you're cool doesn't mean you can't be smart. But it's just like you said. You and all my smart friends don't care what the cool kids think, and the cool kids don't care what you guys think. These platforms are perfect. Thanks, Eugene. Anytime, just to be sure you don't fall off. Fall off of what? The platforms. It's a metaphor. Good luck, I guess. Are you talking to cool Jackie or smart Jackie? I'm talking to you, just Jackie. Well, you can kiss just Jackie goodbye. Yes. It's a metaphor, Eugene.
All right, students, so tonight marks the start of the student council election debates. First, we have Jackie Sanders running against Jackie Sanders for the position of student council president.
Thank you, Mr. Gordon, and thanks to you all for being here tonight, but I would like to make a change to the ballots. Your candidates for student council president are cool Jackie and smart Jackie.
Okay, so now welcome Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I am killing it tonight.
Mr. Gordman!
Okay, so now welcome cool Jackie and smart Jackie.
Thanks, Mr. Gordman. Aren't you guys? First of all, with me as president, the DJ for the homecoming dance will be, you guessed it, DJ Mr. Cool. Not only that, but with me as president, all of your vending machines will be stocked full of your favorite pops and candy bars. I, too, will make this homecoming dance the most successful one to date, but I will do so by carefully balancing the budget, thus being able to increase our profits, being able to implement vending machines with the healthy snacks to improve the health of our student body.
Talk about snooze cruise. Look smart, Jackie. No one wants your gluten-free, sugar-free, fun-free snacks if the homecoming dance isn't awesome, which, with me as president, is possible. And how do you plan to make that possible? You can't just come to these grand conjectures and hope that no one notices that we lack funding and materials to achieve your goals. Honestly, Smart Jackie, this is why no one likes you. Well, at least when I was in eighth grade, I didn't throw up after chugging my milk at lunch. First of all, that was you. And second of all, I wasn't the one that showed up in an inflato sumo wrestler costume on Halloween freshman year because no one told me that you don't wear costumes in high school. Honestly, Jackie, this is why no one likes you. You're mean and negative and you only think about yourself. And I'm not even talking to Cool Jackie or Smart Jackie. I'm just talking to Jackie. You're not good enough.
You know, the one thing no one realizes about running against yourself for president is that you're guaranteed to win, but you're also guaranteed to lose. I can't do this. I concede. I understand the metaphor now, Eugene.
Well, folks, seeing as both our candidates for student council president have now conceded the race, it looks like I'm going to have to step in as next year's student council president. Just kidding, that's against the rules.
Hey, Courtney, you're friends with Jackie, right? Yeah, what happened to her last night was so sad. She's been my president since, like, the first grade.
Exactly. Last night, we saw a side of Jackie that we've never seen before. She wasn't just focused on school or friends or student council. She was real.
What are you trying to say, Eugene?
Jackie conceded. Well, technically, Cool Jackie and Smart Jackie conceded, but no one wants Cool Jackie or Smart Jackie for president. We want just Jackie.
All right, kids, listen up. I have the results from your student council election. For secretary, we have Don Zelaitis. For treasurer, we have Alyssa Rodriguez. For vice president, we have Denzel Washington. Denzel, is that really your name?
Well, okay.
And thank you to Jimmy Smith, who kindly took Jackie Sanders' place in the presidential election.
What's that?
There was a write-in. Well, shucks, by 450 votes, Jackie Sanders has won the presidential election.
I did?
How is it even? Look, Jackie, you know this school better than anyone. Sure, I don't care about healthy foods in the vending machine, and I don't care about dances. Trust me, I have DJ Mr. Cool at my bar mitzvah. He's not that cool. But you care about all of it, and that's not easy to do. Plus, there's a meme of you crying on my Instagram that already got me 500 likes. Hey, kidding. But that was a side of you that we've never seen before. And frankly, that's who I want in charge. Thanks, guys. Now I just have to start my campaign for homecoming queen.
This event is similar to DDA, but actors perform a scene of comedy.
When asked to provide a fun fact about herself, Mary said, quote, I'm in English right now. And Charlotte fosters puppies with her family.
Mary and Charlotte performing the book, The Boy Book.
Me neither. My sister gave it to me, told me to only share it with my best friend. She can't tell anyone about it. You promise?
I promise.
Who'd have thought there was actually a book that told women everything they need to know about men?
I know. Look at the cover. The Boy Book.
Now I know why they say girls mature faster than boys.
It's because of the book.
Cool. Let's read it. This looks like a good chapter. Phrases you need to know when turning down a guy for a date. This looks like a good one. You are very nice. Insert name. You're like a brother to me.
Wow, good one. Let him down easy. Here, let me see. I'd love to go on a date with you, insert name, but I'm waiting to get a phone call from this guy I like.
Not too subtle, but effective.
Yeah. Hey, look at this one. It's bolded and underlined.
It says to only use in extreme circumstances.
I like you as a friend.
Jeez, Dolphins! Ah! This book rocks.
Totally.
Growing up is tough, especially as a girl in a male-dominated society.
It's time to flip the script.
In the immortal words of Beyonce,
who run the world?
Girls.
The Boy Book.
By John C. Evans.
Jeez, Dolphins! Ah!
Look, it recommends doing some practices for exercise.
Like a workbook?
I guess so.
Yeah!
Here's the first one, playing hard to get. Do you want to be the boy or the girl?
I'll be the boy.
Okay. I like you, you like me, but I pretend I don't like you to make you like me more.
Is that what the book says?
Yeah.
That doesn't make sense.
It's in the book.
Okay, all right, I'm gonna be the boy now. Watch this.
Ugh, what's up, Julie? Would you like to go on a date with me?
As if.
Well, Valerie Van Putin said you liked me during gym class.
In your dreams.
But...
Tap the hand, not the face.
Wow, that was great. I feel like a total idiot.
That's what the book said would happen.
Okay, you want to try one now?
Sure, I'll try this one.
Okay, it's called You Know He's Trying to Ask You Out, but you make him stammer on and on just for the fun of it.
That's a good one. I'll be the geeky type. Hi there.
Are you talking to me?
Well, yeah, you see, like, I just thought that me.
I can't hear you.
I said that I just thought that.
What's your point?
Well, I was getting to that, you see. We're in chemistry class together, and I thought I saw you looking at me, and I got really excited.
After you've made him stammer on and on as long as possible, try to embarrass him as well. OMG, are you asking me out?
Well, yeah.
Let's see if it refers back to, oh, yes. Sorry, geek guy, I like you.
As a friend.
No!
That really works.
Totally.
And it felt kind of good in a cruel sort of way.
Well, I mean, girls have it harder than boys, see? We have to wait for them to ask us out. Then if we don't want to, we have to feel guilty for saying no.
Wait! No, you don't!
Don't feel guilty for saying
no! Jinx! Don't Jinx! Ah! I love this book.
Me too.
Let's keep going. Okay. Body language is essential with a guy. Let him know how you feel with a touch or a look.
That makes sense. Want to try it out?
Sure. I'll look at you or touch you, and you tell me what signal you think I'm sending off.
Okay.
You want to have my baby?
Too much.
Unless you're on the Jerry Springer show. Try again.
Okay. How's this?
Very nice. Coy, flirtatious, but subtle.
Okay. You want to try one now?
Sure. I'll try the touch thing. Tell a joke and I'll pretend I like you.
Okay, ready? Watch this.
What'd the snail say while he was rotting the turtle's back?
I don't know. What?
Whoopee.
That's not funny.
The book.
That's so funny! You are so funny!
Calm down there, Chuckles.
Too much?
Unless you're trying to steal his wallet, try again.
Okay.
So the snail says, whoopee.
That's so funny. You are so funny.
That was great! How'd you come up with that hair thing?
It's in the book. Boys love it when girls play with their hair.
Is that true?
It's in the flirting without words section.
What else does it say?
When walking with the boy you like, stay silent and stare until he passes by. Then look back, whisper, and giggle.
This will drive boys crazy.
Watch this. Silent, stare, whisper, giggle. Got it, what's next?
Calling the guy you like, but pretending you didn't.
Let's do that one. I'll be the girl.
I'll be the guy.
Ring, 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 ring. I said, ring, 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 ring.
Yeah.
Steve?
Yeah.
Oh, I meant to call my friend Stephanie and I must have dialed you. This is Julie from your algebra class.
Oh, hey Julie. Did you stare at me today and then whisper and giggle to your friend?
Well, yes I did.
That was amazing. Would you maybe like to go out with me?
Sure, I guess.
Yes! Ooh, here's a good tip. When calling the guy you like and his parents pick up, brown nose as much as possible. Exaggerate and lie if necessary.
I'll be the mom.
I'll be the girl. Ring, 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 ring.
Hello.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Steve's mom. This is Sue from Steve's algebra class.
Why, hello, Susan.
I was just calling to tell you that I had one of your white macadamia nut cookies at the bake sale, and it was delicious.
Oh, how sweet.
I also wanted to tell you that your house is beautiful. My dad's a landscaper, and he says your shrubberies are the best in town.
Oh, how wonderful, Susan. I'll have to tell my husband. He'll be simply thrilled.
Okay, I'm gonna go now and have another one of your delicious cookies. Oh, and by the way, could you tell your son Stephen I called to say hello?
Why, of course, dear. Stephen, the lovely girl Susan from your algebra class called. You should ask her out.
What? What was that?
No, I'm sure she doesn't think you're like a brother to her.
Good reaction.
Yeah, well done. What's next? Skip ahead.
Whoa.
What?
This is huge.
What is it?
Getting him to say, I love you first.
Whoa.
It takes up a whole 2 chapters.
Do you think some guys are off somewhere reading a book called, like, The Girl Book?
You mean to tell me there's a book exactly like this one, but for guys telling them to do things like not call us right after a date or they'll look like a wuss?
Yeah, something like that. Do you think there's a way guys could get one step ahead of us girls somehow? Nah. Jinx! Double jinx!
Where the speaker chooses a realistic yet fictional audience. The speech is generally a persuasive speech that contains a great deal of personality and humor.
Again, you will be seeing Lily, and Lily loves the movie Aquamarine.
Here's Lily's SOS, Like a Girl.
I don't mean to silence any voices, but it's time to get started. As your Ottawoman, you know, like Ottoman, chairman, but less, I now call this meeting of the Girls Leading America movement, GLAM, to order. The fact that this club brings both boys and girls together in an effort to get more girls into leadership is a truly beautiful thing, but we have an ugly problem. There are 50 girls in this club, but none of us have ever been president. How can we call ourselves GLAM if we can't even move girls to lead in our own club? We should really call ourselves Girls Rarely Overcome Silly Stereotypes. Gross. But we're not gross, we're GLAM, so we need to figure out how to change our ways, and fast. The main factor keeping girls from taking charge is the negative language used toward women in leadership. We must use our bossiness to whine about the problem, get overly emotional about the effects, and be pushy to implement some solutions. GLAM can finally get to doing some glamming. We just need to get past the language that's holding us back. I know what you're thinking. I'm being irrational and a little overly dramatic. But trust me, I've researched this a ton and practiced this in the mirror about 100 times. And your thoughts are really just proving my point, so thank you. There is an obvious and unnecessary double standard in the way we discuss men and women in leadership. In her book, Why Congress Needs Women, Bringing Sanity to the House and Senate, Michelle Paludi reveals, if a statement released by a male politician is viewed as a sign of his authority, confidence, or power, the same statement revealed by a female politician would be viewed as a sign of her high-handedness, demandingness, or how she's too cold. Too cold. Maybe that's what Ice Ice Baby is about. Or maybe we just need to stop, collaborate, and listen, am I right? Our opposing views on men and women exhibiting the same behavior stems from an age-old stereotype of what women are supposed to be. In NPR article, Too Sweet, Too Shrill, The Double Bind for Women, Alice Eagly highlights the idea that women are expected to be nice, kind, and friendly.
Yet leaders are expected to be tough and decisive. When people see women exhibiting leadership qualities, they feel the need to emphasize that she's no longer exhibiting feminine characteristics, calling her bossy, unbecoming, or unladylike. Last time I checked, the only thing that makes you unladylike is being a man. Okay, Glam, the problem is not mean words. We know how to deal with people calling us bad names. I'm rubber, you're glue, whatever you say bounces off me and sticks to you. The problem is the implications that these words carry. According to banbossy.org, when little girls hear these words, it sends a message. Don't speak up or raise your hand. Then, by middle school, girls are less interested in leading than boys because they're twice as likely as boys to fear that leading will make them seem bossy. Hearing these words teaches little girls that leading just isn't something for them. Which is as silly as the idea that tools aren't for girls. If you don't know the drill, let me hammer it in. Boys and girls are on the same level. Nailed it. This idea that leading just isn't a girly thing is the reason that according to the Catalyst Research Center, women currently hold 22 CEO positions at S&P 500 companies. That's 4.4%. That's 5.6% less than the percentage of Americans who eat ice cream for breakfast. 9.88% less than the percentage of Americans who can't locate the United States on a map, and 66.6% less than the percentage of Americans who admit to picking their nose. Now that's gross. Similarly, according to a study done by UN Women, it was found that only 11 elected heads of state in the world are women. Only 11. In the whole entire world. Who run the world? Boys. But don't worry, Beyonce, it doesn't have to be that way. Okay, Glam, now let's get information to talk about some solutions. We do not have to be held back by the negative stigma surrounding the language used toward women in leadership, but it will take men and women alike. First, women, we must reclaim the words meant to make us seem inadequate. According to Kathleen Jameson, director of the Annenberg Public Policy Center at the University of Pennsylvania, reclaiming pejoratives is a powerful means of changing the original use of the word. It invites reflection on the original use. It's a jujitsu move. Yeah. Okay, so not exactly like that, but according to New York Times article, reclaiming words that smear, when Senator Claire McCaskill was called unladylike by her opponent, she decided instead of letting it bring her down, she would reclaim it. She then built her campaign around the idea that speaking up, taking charge, being strong, and changing the world are all very, very ladylike. Now boys, don't forget that you play a role in this too. All of us here need to be aware of the language we use and the message that we're sending. Deborah Tannen, linguistics professor at Georgetown, recommends before we call a woman bossy, we think about what we would call a man in the same position. This theory can be applied to any negative gender term. By doing this, we'll be less likely to use these words and more likely to say what we actually mean. Every girl in Glam is powerful. Every girl in Glam is capable of being a leader. The number of girls in leadership in Glam and in the world does not at all reflect the number of girl leaders in Glam and in the world. The number of girls in leadership can and will go up if we simply get past the stigma created by the language used toward women in leadership. By being aggressive and explaining that there is a problem, describing the unbecoming effects and getting a little unladylike with the solutions, I hope we all realize that this problem is far-reaching but can be stopped. If we end the judgment, we won't just be Glam, we'll be Glad. Girls leading America daringly. Let's not focus on whether or not she's bossy. Let's make sure she's a boss. Thank you.
Next, you will be seeing an info event. This is an event where the speaker presents an original speech that they have researched, organized, and developed to express their own interest.
Spiro is often referred to as Spyro when announced for awards. And with no prior acting experience, Spiro and Miles entered an improvisational duet acting this season and got sixth place.
Now, Spiro performing Don't Bubble Us In.
After watching a thought-provoking TED Talk about online searches this summer, I asked two of my friends to type the word Olympics into Google search bar, and for them to send me a screenshot of their results. One friend's computer screen listed links related to the Ryan Lochte scandal, while the other friend had no such result, but simply medal counts and instant replays. Now, why is it that when the same word, searched with the same search engine, on the same day, produced two different sets of results? What may seem like an internet glitch is actually what Google and every other website is designed to do. It is called the filter bubble. And in his TED Talk, Beware of Online Filter Bubbles, political and internet activist Eli Pariser describes it as an invisible algorithmic editing of the web that depends on who you are and what you search. In order to fully understand the filter bubble, we must first take a look at how it grew to control the entire web over time. Next, we need to analyze the pros and cons before we discover the harm it implies to our digital future and what must be done in order to stop it. Evidently, the World Wide Web is not as wide as once thought, or rather as personalized for individual users. If I had not used Google in my experiment, but instead chose Facebook, Yahoo News, Bing, yes, Bing still exists, or anything else in the web that contained a search bar, the results would be the exact same. Because over the past decade, the filter bubble grew to control not just Google, but all parts of the interactive web. As said by Pariser in his book, The Filter Bubble, What the Internet is Hiding from You, Google announced its personalized search in December of 2010. And from that day on, Google's server included an algorithm that took account 57 different signals. Everything from your computer type, to your location, your recent search and click history, and even more, to make guesses about what kind of sites you would like to see, therefore filtering you into your own bubble. This marked the beginning of the personalized web. Then came Facebook, where your newsfeed is filtered by the algorithm depending on what side of the political spectrum you fall on. It was not long until this algorithm then ventured its way into common streaming applications. While scrolling through the extensive amount of options on Netflix, you must have come across a section that states, suggestions for you. Well, according to the case study titled, The Effect of Using Recommender Systems on Content Diversity by Tian Nguyen, streaming applications take note of your previously watched programs, processes this information with its algorithm, and produces similar shows, ultimately personalizing the way you stream TV. But it's weird because my suggestion category keeps popping up Legally Blonde 2, and I can assure you I have not seen the first one in the last 5 hours. Additionally, Pariser also explained that even shopping websites, including Amazon, have algorithmic filtering going on, where your purchase history is used to produce similar items for you to buy in the future. As you can see, the filter bubble has grown to control our entire internet, which brought some benefits, but quite the handful of problems as well. While I looked at the results of my experiment, the way Google personalized the word Olympics differently for my two friends was very noticeable. Interestingly enough, this personalization is sought to serve as both a burden and a benefit to our internet use. Ever since the creation of the filter bubble back in 2010, certain people have stated support of this new personalized web, including Facebook scientist Eitan Bakshi, in his case study performed to highlight the benefits of Facebook's filter bubble. According to this study, if there is any filtering going on, it is simply to make the site more convenient for its users. Not just Facebook, but this can be applied to all other parts of the web. Think about it. Not everyone has the time to scroll through the entire Amazon shoe collection, or every news story posted to our BuzzFeed subscription about Kanye's next move. fact, she then proves that for the average user, Facebook's algorithm only produces about 6% more news that you agree with than news that you disagree with. Therefore, you are not really put into this dangerous bubble as Preezer claimed. But Bakshi does not consider the other side of the argument, and why this is also a negative to our internet use, which is the main focus of the Daily Dilemma sequence titled, How Google and Facebook Distort Your Worldview. The British talk show begins by explaining how Bakshi's statistic does not take into account of how partisan your posts are. The video goes on to explain that Facebook's algorithm has the ability to blind you from worldviews, and this blinding expands much farther than just Facebook. The list continues for both sides of the aisle, and there is no definitive answer of whether or not this filter bubble is a positive or negative until we look at how this will affect our future. As I stood there, surprised by the outcome of my Google experiment, I began to worry over what this meant for the future digital generation, and I was not alone. Even though many people in the tech field support the use of the filter bubble, most scientists recognize its problematic future. The overwhelming majority of analysts view internet personalization as a negative to our internet society, which is the main focus of The Guardian's article by Roy Greensill. The article begins by explaining how users of social media continuously pour information about themselves into their accounts, which the site then uses to produce political advertisements solely around that person's views. This is a source of targeting journalism that directs certain news stories to certain people. This not only strengthens their bias, but makes them less informed by little exposure to facts from the other side. The end products of the cycle are people preaching incorrect information and overconfident Americans on Twitter during election seasons. And I'm pretty sure we all had a fair share of that this past year. However, some are trying to reverse this downward spiral and create an alternative that will transform our digital future into an unbiased internet. In hope to flip-flop the system altogether, MIT Tech Review's article, How to Burst the Bubble That Protects Us from Opposing Views, explains how Eduardo Garrido in Barcelona, Spain, built a recommendation engine that collects data of thousands of social media users' opinions on several different key topics. The system then cleverly groups people into pairs using the same technology as a filter bubble's algorithm. But instead of sharing similar stances, the system pairs two people up with the most opposing views on a given idea. This is done to produce controversy, insightful thinking, and bipartisan interaction that was nearly impossible on a social media site before. Although this was just a case study, Garrido marked the beginning of a new era that will inspire others to fight web isolation and move towards an unfiltered internet environment. As you can see from my personal experience, the filter bubble has grown to control our entire internet and shows no signs of slowing down in the near future. Today, we explored its history before going on to see the pros and cons until finally understanding the implications. From what started as a simple algorithm that personalized your search eventually grew into a dominating system that blocks you from different ideas and opinions. Just how Holocaust survivor Elie Wiesel once said, learn from the otherness of the other. Long before the filter bubble was even created, people viewed another person's thoughts and ideas as valuable to ourselves and our society. But if this advice is not followed, our world will not be cohesive, but filtered by a digital bubble.
We will see a poetry piece. Poetry is when a speaker performs a unique reading of a longer poetry piece that expresses a common theme.
Shanti is secretly an amazing hula hooper.
So here is Shanti with 12 steps to becoming an all-American teenage girl.
Purse your lips so they pout, so they are fleshy and pink like salmon curled upward on teakwood. All shiny, Smile and breathe through your nose. There. That's it. On her first day of school after immigrating to this country from India, my mother was asked a question. She stood up, answered the question, and sat back down as she would have back in India. Promptly after class, a couple white girls pulled her into the bathroom and explained to her, "We don't do that here." Fast forward to today, where the most ethnic thing about me is my name. All Indian clothing is hidden in a back closet, and the closest thing that I get to a home-cooked Indian meal is reheated takeout. I pray that my mother's experiences were nothing like what happens in 12 Steps to Becoming an All-American Teenage Girl by Charulata Sinha. Shut up. 2, join a fashion club at school. Learn to do things with fabric and sequins. Your fingers will grip the needles like pencils. This hurts. You have blisters now, but look at all those pretty buttons. Make a scarf or something. You're a woman, so it'll come naturally, in time. 3, when you realize brown girls are built differently, take extra precaution. Burn your passport. Grease the machinery in your tongue for staccato vowels and sharp, "Hi, how are you?" Bleach your skin. Pray they don't notice. 4, throw away your overalls, your bug collection, your marble ganache, your paper mache rocket. You'll need space for the sequins. 5, find a boy with leather seats and a bobblehead on the dashboard. Let him stick his tongue down your throat when you're pressed up against the cup holder. Swallow hard. Try to picture your paper rocket in the air connecting the constellations. You could never get it to fly. 6, when they ask you to do an accent, make them laugh. Throw in a couple cow jokes, a call center joke. Pray they do notice. Realize you work the day shift as apple pie ingenue, and only moonlight as exotic when they show up at your door late at night. Lips dry and mouths full of sand. Tongues wagging for cardamom and peppercorn and bay leaf. 7, familiarize yourself with the taste of beer and the taste of concrete. Soon you'll forget the smell of old books. Soon you'll find that your feet can't ride your old bike. The gears have shifted and the brakes are sticky. Don't worry, the boy will drive you around. 8, throw your dupatta in the washing machine. Stain it and shrink it. Tell your mother you cannot possibly wear it. You are Irish. This is Ellis Island. This is a passage and promised land. Deportation is a ship too rocky for your land legs. They will check your tongue for cholera just as you swallow the last grains of Calcutta soil. Swallow hard. Remember your rocket. 9, they will tease the kid with the turban. Pretend you don't know this. 10, the marigold flowers will be offered to you as a blessing. Your grandmother will kiss them and pray for you. A good husband, please. Sex is bullshit, you think, as you wax your skin smooth to the boys like him. The puja bloom will stick to your bleached palms, and you will scrub and scrub, but for days your fingers will smell like sandalwood, like tumor, like knotted basmati rice. The boy will ask you if you're using a new perfume. You will shake your head. No, he must be imagining things. 10. Practice your laugh in front of a mirror. Brown girls don't laugh like that. Certainly not in front of men, but this is America. Giggle in this way when the boy makes the crack about the Kama Sutra at a party. Don't try to stretch your feet out in your pigeonhole. Remember that America is liberating you. Remember your feathers are the color of dirt. The ground is logically your rightful place. Giggle again. Dig and dig. Stuff your sandalwood palms in your pockets. Pray they notice the bleach is working. Pray they don't notice the soil underneath your fingernails and the blood from your vermilion roots working their way into the light. 11. As you walk down the aisle wearing a beautiful white dress to marry the beautiful white man you love, remember that white is the color traditionally worn to Indian funerals. You are death and rebirth. You are lipstick, Kali and voodoo, brown tribal magic, blonde hair dye, an American wife. How neatly the pieces of your ivory trousseau fit. Smile at this small trophy. You've won something. You cannot tell what. 12. Your skin will start to crack. Rivers of wrinkles, sunspot, and age. They'll tell you it's growing. Do not believe them. Raid the drugstore, slap every lotion, oil, cream onto your unforgiving thighs. Try injections, then surgery. They will object. Do not believe them. You are a woman, an American woman. You do not give up so easy.
Next up, you will be hearing an OO event. This student picks a topic of interest and does some research on this problem, how it affects us, and how we should use this new information in our lives.
Our performer, Josie, is a fan of the Great American Bagel Cinnamon Delight.
Josie performing the preschool problem.
As a kid, I went to Montessori school, and every day I would practice tying shoes, a simple skill that everyone needs to know. However, my brother, who did not go to Montessori school, didn't learn how to tie his shoes until sixth grade. This seemingly simple skill turned into a tornado of problems, because every morning before going outside, my mom would have to tie his shoes for him, adding precious minutes to my school-bound journey. Unlike my brother, I was fortunate enough to have teachers who taught me all these basic skills. In preschool, all of my teachers adapted to the kind of learning that I needed. So now, as a high school student, I credit most of my academic success to them. Without my teachers, I don't think I'd be in such high-level classes with kind of decent social skills. I realize now that many kids are simply shoved into kindergarten without previous exposure to basic skills. And frankly, being pushed violently into a brick building sounds painful. So today, we'll discuss why parents are not sending their kids to preschool, the serious effects on the development of these children, and the surprising solutions that require the support of a whole community. With such a large emphasis placed on preschool by society, it's surprising so few children go. Nearly 60% of students from all economic classes don't attend preschool, according to a press release in the White House. Clearly, something is wrong here, but why do some parents think that preschool is not even an option? Unfortunately, putting kids into preschool isn't easy for every single family. According to the Office of the Press Secretary at the White House, children from low-income families are less likely
to even have access to high-quality early education. A zip code can determine how likely it is a student will go to preschool because preschools are being built too far away for working parents to access. Some communities are regarded as too poor to even afford preschool, but every student deserves the opportunity. This large preschool access gap is a major factor in low registration at preschool, but another huge factor is money. In his Time article, Ethan Wolfman cites a recent study from the Economic Policy Institute, which found that in 23 states, the in-state public college tuition was lower than the cost of full-time childcare for a four-year-old. For us future parents, this is so important because if preschool already costs more than college, the prices will continue to increase. We must reverse this effect now so we'll be able to give our children all the opportunities they deserve without breaking the bank. In addition, the government's money is being spent more on middle and high school education, and Michael Leachman from the Center of Budget and Policy Priorities reports cuts exceeding 10% from preschool to support high school. This may be why preschools have to raise their prices to even stay afloat, and parents who cannot pay these inflated prices can't send their kids to preschool. So the sad truth is that oftentimes, whether or not a child will go to preschool is based on their socioeconomic status and not their needs. Due to the fact that so many kids are missing out on a crucial part of their education, we must analyze both the social and academic impacts on the young students. Pre-K is like a movie preview to all the new adventures that will happen in kindergarten. In the article, What to Expect from Preschool, Social Studies, Diana Butterworth explains that preschool is essential for both social and classroom skills to develop. She points out that the students gain confidence as these skills develop by learning to share, taking turns, and practicing being both leaders and followers. These abilities make it easier for kids to interact with their peers and teachers. However, without them, the students will have limited communication with their teachers, which may cause misunderstandings and arguments. Without this initial push into the social world, the leap is too big from no social interactions to having 20 people around you all day. A little traumatic, right? If students are forced into this shocking transition in kindergarten without knowing how to react or handle these new experiences, then one of the only ways they'll be able to express themselves is through lashing out. In her article for Rasmussen College, Ashley Brooks says that sometimes tantrums are the only way students are able to express their emotions. And as they grow older, tantrum behavior becomes less and less acceptable. Social skills follow students through their entire lives, and it is vital to begin to learn them immediately. Another major setback for kids who skip pre-K is they lack the firm basis to read at the speed and accuracy of everyone else in their grade. The former Secretary of Education, Arne Duncan, says that without basic reading and even speaking skills, a student could end up 12 to 14 months behind their peers. To even be considered average, these students must work twice as hard in kindergarten to catch up. And if they're behind in reading, it is likely they'll be behind in many other subjects too. Without these basic reading and even math skills, a student could be behind for his or her entire school career. Parents need to understand that they are putting their children at a disadvantage by not giving them the vital educational years in preschool. However, all is not lost. By changing a few things about preschool, we can solve this issue. First, those with the means to send their children to preschool should. In addition, the Office of Chicago Public Schools has a simple yet innovative idea about how to make parents feel more comfortable paying for preschool. They've implemented a program that calculates how much a parent will need to pay based on salary. This means that if a parent has a low salary, they don't have to worry about a flat rate that is not adjusted to them. They still have some financial responsibility to pay a bit for preschool, but instead of taking a massive chunk out of a paycheck,
it will be less impactful for parents. Another great idea is from an organization called Community Organizing Family Issues. Ellen Schumer, the executive director, writes about something called a walking school bus. A walking school bus is when parent volunteers, called conductors, walk into neighborhoods with low transportation capabilities or neighborhoods that have students with low attendance rates and walks kids to preschool. This solves a transportation problem in so many ways because now parents don't have to worry about how to pay for gasoline, buses, or be fearful for their child's safety when walking to school. There's always a need for more conductors, and if we volunteer just half an hour a day, it'll be nothing compared to the benefit we will be giving the young students. Overall, preschool is arguably the most important time in a student's academic career. Today, we talked about the difficulty of getting kids into preschool, the degrading effects of skipping pre-K, and the possible solutions that can set children on a path to be successful in school. In the end, it shouldn't matter where a child lives, how much money a family has, or how much a person already knows. Every young student deserves the opportunity to be whatever their hearts desire, including a shoe-tying expert.
Next up, we have radio. Radio speaking is the presentation of a newscast, including a commercial.
Elizabeth is an avid baker.
So here's Elizabeth with radio.
Avalanche Crush Italian Hotel. Donald Trump elected as the 45th president. University of Illinois wants to boost enrollment. Hi, this is Elizabeth Allen for WEKT with your news brought to you by Byron's Food Shop. Across the pond, rescue crews located up to 8 people alive in the kitchen of an avalanche-crushed hotel on Friday, an incredible discovery that boosted spirits 2 days after the massive snowslide buried around 30 people in the resort. Video released by rescuers showed a boy wearing blue snow pants and a matching ski shirt emerging from the structure and crews muzzing his hair in celebration. Next was a woman with a long ponytail wearing red snow pants. The survivors appeared fully alert and walking on their own. Both were helped down to a stretcher for the helicopter ride out. In the UK, Britain's Royal Navy on Friday removed a still dangerous World War II bomb whose discovery in the River Thames shut down a chunk of central London. The Metropolitan Police Force were called Thursday afternoon to report the suspected World War II items in the river, found by a dredger near the Houses of Parliament. Police blocked off roads in the area and closed 2 bridges over the river. Nearby, Westminster subway station also was shut. Navy disposal teams towed the 2-foot-by-1-foot device downriver to Tilbury in the Thames estuary. Closer to home, on the morning 19 months ago when Donald Trump descended the escalator in his glitzy Manhattan Tower, waving to onlookers who lined the rails, many Americans knew little about him beyond that he was very rich and had a thing for firing people on a reality television show. No one could possibly say that they knew the man who launched his candidacy the day that he would be elected the nation's 45th president. As Trump took the oath of office Friday, many Americans still can't quite believe that a presidency that seems almost bizarrely improbable became a reality on Friday. Over on the East Coast, notorious Mexican drug kingpin Joaquin El Chapo Guzman is in a U.S. courthouse 2 decades after he was first sought out by federal authorities. The convicted leader of the Sinaloa cartel was brought into a Brooklyn courthouse on Friday to await his appearance before a federal judge. An indictment charges Guzman with running a massive drug operation that laundered billions of dollars and oversaw murders and kidnappings. Back in Lincoln's land, University of Illinois is rolling out an ambitious effort to boost enrollment by 15% over the next 5 years, growing the 3 campuses to more than 93,600 students. School leaders are aiming to add around 12,150 students by 2021, pinpointing increases in undergraduate programs at the Chicago campus and graduate and online programs in Urbana-Champaign. The move comes as the university system tries to attract more Illinoisans and underrepresented minorities. As part of the battle to remain an attractive option for those students, university leaders are also poised to approve a tuition freeze for incoming Illinois students for the third straight year. In Springfield, the Illinois Historic Preservation Agency added 25 significant properties to the National Register of Historic Places in 2016. Agency officials announced Thursday that the sites included a farmhouse designed by Frank Lloyd Wright, a manufacturing district in Chicago, and a church that helped create gospel music. The National Park Service made the designations based on the state agency recommendations. In addition to the 25 new locations, two existing sites had their designations expanded. Heading to sports and weather, after a break from our sponsor. Tired of eating fast food whenever you're in a hurry at mealtime? It's time for you to return to the good old days of home cooking at your neighborhood deli. Byron's Food Shop is that place. Scrumptious homemade salads, mouth-watering cheesy potatoes, and fresh steamed table ribs. Roast chicken and daily specials. Don't end up fast food supersizing yourself one more time. Byron's Food Shop, return to the good old days of home cooking. Dribbling right in, the Wizards beat the Knicks 113-110. The Suns lost 118-103 against the Cavaliers. The Heat beat the Mavericks 99-95. The Spurs crushed the Nuggets 118-104. Over to weather, today there's a high of 56 degrees and a low of 40 degrees, with it being cloudy. On Sunday, the high drops slightly to 53 degrees and 38 degrees for the low. The clouds will stay around. Starting off the week on Monday, it's getting chillier with a high of 44 degrees and a low of 38 degrees. Expect showers at night. Make sure to wear all of your winter essentials this very cold weekend. Thank you for listening to WEKT with your news brought to you by Byron's Food Shop. You've been all in with Elizabeth Allen. Have a great rest of your day, Chicago.
Lastly, you will be seeing an HI. This event, the speaker performs a comedic scene from a play, memorizes and develops an interpretation of each character and the action of the scene.
Pilar is often referred to as Pillar when announced for awards.
Pilar performing Camp Sunshine.
My name's Gloria, that's G-L-O-R-I-A, and I'm your camp social director. Say, are you ready for a fun-filled week or what? You know, Camp Sunshine is just the biggest and best Bible camp in all of Arkansas. And you know why? It's because God created it. That's right. One day, God was walking down Interstate 129, just outside of Little Rock, and he said, wow, what a great place for a camp. Yes, he did. It's in the Bible somewhere. No, don't look for it, Lucille. It's in the newer versions only. Dear Mommy and Daddy, this is your lonely and abandoned daughter, Lucille. This is my first day at camp. I hate it. The social director reminds me of Aunt Midge, the one who nobody likes. My bunkmate is a girl named Margot who spends all our small group prayer time staring at boys' butts. This is her eighth year at camp, and she snagged a different boy every year. That's the only reason she comes. She says Christian boys are easier to fool. We're supposed to meet the sports director this afternoon. His name's Uncle Ernie. I hope he's nice. All right, you guys, snap to! Let me make one thing clear. God don't want no spindly-legged wimps. When you climb that styrofoam mountain this afternoon, I want you to climb like the devil himself was right on your butt. You hear me? My name's Uncle Ernie, and I'm in charge of showing you God's love through athletics. You ever heard of Gabriel? He was a by-golly-stomping archangel. I ain't talking no wimpy little precious moments cherubs here, gentlemen. I'm talking power. You hear me? I said power. Repeat after me. Power. Amen. Dear Mommy and Daddy, Uncle Ernie is a creep. Today, he ran into an oak tree head first to show us how God's love can protect us. I guess God was looking the other way because Uncle Ernie nearly bashed his brains in. He got a concussion, but he says it only made him tougher for God. Now, he's not only a creep, but he's a stupid creep.
Will you please come get me? Growing up, my mom always talked about the Fab Four. No, not the Beatles. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. She was their biggest fan. And of course, now I am too, especially after experiencing all the campfires, sing-alongs, and Holy Ghost stories at Camp Sunshine by Ken Bradbury. Good morning, campers. It's Gloria again. That's G-L-O-R-I-A. Say, how are my little campers doing on their second day at Camp Sunshine? Hunky Dory, that's the Camp Sunshine spirit. Well, you'll never guess what we have planned for you today. First, the Isaiah group will be in the craft hall with, you guessed it, leather and bead working. Today's extra special project is the Seven Plagues of Egypt bookmarker. Something to take home to your grandmothers. The Jeremiah group will be going out on our world famous Great Birds of the Bible bird hunt. Be sure you have your gun permits with you. And the Joshua group, who was supposed to go with Uncle Ernie to learn how to make a rope bridge across Gator Swamp. Well, Uncle Ernie isn't quite himself today. Satan dealt him a powerful blow, but he'll be back tomorrow after brain surgery. Instead, the Joshua group has been a fun-filled hour memorizing the book of 1 Kings to the accompaniment of Sandy Patty tapes. Wow, I sure wish I could be in that one. Dear Mommy and Daddy, this is Lucille. I'm really sick of Sandy Patty. I've got a bump to myself now. They caught Margo making out with Skip Henderson during evening vespers and flag raisings. They're making her wash dishes with a nun for punishment. Dear Spike, this is Skip. They say I gotta write a lousy letter every day, and I hate to write, so I figured I'd write to you since you can barely read. I met this really hot chick named Margo. They caught us making out last night, but it was totally worth it. I don't think Margo's a Baptist. From what I've heard the old man say, I'd say she's a Democrat. All right, you guys, Satan got me with that oak tree, but it'll take more than that to keep a man of God down for long. Today, I want to talk to you about pain. Now, if you don't know pain, then you just don't know God. God made pain. And if you ain't just about half miserable, then you can't truly know the love of God. Today, we're going to play a little game. It's called the Pain Game. It's a test to see who truly knows the love of God and who's a by golly pinko communist atheist. What I have here is a lit candle. Dear Mommy and Daddy, this is Lucille. Do you hate me? Dear Lucille, this is Margo. You've got to get me out of here. I've washed 600 dishes and the nun just threatened to kill me. I asked G-L-O-R-E-A Gloria what a nun was doing washing dishes in a Baptist church camp. She told me that a nun was just an unmarried Baptist and that it was to be a lesson to us. Did you? See, Skip, and that swimsuit? I was drying dishes by the window when I saw him and dropped the gravy boat. Sister Dishwater hailed Mary for me, but the buns on that boy are worth it. Good evening, campers. Is that not you've all been waiting for? Tell it not. Yes, so we've got a few cancellations. Uncle Ernie can't sing the Marines hymn due to third-degree burns on his right hand, but we've got some other really neato stuff that's just gonna make your spirits soar. Okay, okay. First, we have the Isaiah group playing Handel's Messiah on the spoons. Let's give it up for Isaiah. Dear Skip, this is Margo. Meet me tonight on a retribution point. Dear Margo, this is Skip. How will I find you in the dark? Dear idiot, feel your way around. Dear smart aleck, that's how I got in trouble with the flag raising. All right, guys, Satan, he tried to get his hooks in me, but it'll take more than an oak tree and a fir to keep Uncle Ernie down for long. Today, I want to talk to you about suffering. All right, I know it's summer camp, and the robins are singing, and your hormones are running like a jackrabbit in a brush fire, but tonight, I'm going to use self-control. Mind over matter. Let me tell you about my stint in the Marine Corps. Dear Mommy and Daddy, this is Lucille. It's been a dull day. Margo and Skip were excommunicated from the Baptist church last night. We met for the ceremony out on Love, Hope, and Charity Memorial softball field. Margo was stripped of all her Sunday school perfect attendance pins, and Uncle Ernie baptized Skip in a really cold shower. Good morning, campers. Here we are on our final day at Camp Sunshine. I sure am gonna miss you, kiddos, and I don't know if I can wait a whole year to see you back again. As you take your final Camp Sunshine Bible quiz, I want you to think of me, Gloria, G-L-O-R-I-A, and what an inspiration I have been to you all. Dear Mommy and Daddy, this is Lucille.
I think I failed my happy camper test. I know you're coming to get me now, but this will save you from having to tell you on the way home. Our test was on Great Heroes of the Bible, and GLORA Gloria asked if there were any questions. I asked her what begat meant, since it seems like that's all the Bible heroes ever did. She made me wash dishes with a nun for punishment. All right, campers, it has been my pleasure as camp athletic director to lead you to that higher ground, to that great boot camp in the sky. And I want to apologize to those of you in Jeremiah Cabin for what happened last night. I've eaten broken glass several times in the occasion of the Lord, but that was the first time I ever got hiccups. I just got word that little Marjorie Swenson has had most of the fragments removed from her right eye. I hope to see you all back again next year when the theme will be, if Job hadn't suffered, he'd never have made the NFL. Dear Margot, this is Lucille. I'm sending this letter home with your parole officer. He says he'll be seeing you every week. I was really sorry about what happened to you and Skip. GLORA Gloria says you both must have had some Methodist in your blood to pull such a trick. It was too bad you had to go early. The next camp was coming in as we left. It was the Australians for God powerlifting camp. You really would have liked their outfits. Well, I can see Mom and Dad's car coming up Damnation Boulevard now, so I've got to go. I really hope they didn't get all my letters. I'd actually like to come back next year. I'm thinking of applying for the job of camp athletic director. As a farewell demonstration of God's power, Uncle Ernie tried to jump off the rec hall roof blindfolded. I sure hope God is forgiving, because Uncle Ernie forgot about Sister Phillips' barbecue grill. Love you, Lucille.
That concludes our regional performance. Thank you so much for coming out tonight.
And please wish all the performers you see good luck for regionals this Saturday.